They need a hat pin. Hello friends, welcome back to my channel. I'm Cecile and I'm the plus size costumer. If you remember in our last video, I talked about hat pins. Well, I've made one so far, just to make sure everything would go all right. But now I'm going to show you how to make hat pins. That way you can have them to wear with your gorgeous hats and wear it with your gorgeous outfits. And with that, let's get making some hat pins. First of all, you need to gather your tools together, your components. So these are a couple of hat pins. This one is 8.5 inches. No, not 8.5, 8 inches. And this one is 6.5. Both will work, depending on the size of your hat. If you have a hat with a small crown and you've got a small head and you only put your hair up in a small bun, or, you know, if you don't have a lot of hair to poke your hat pin into, then the 6.5 will work. They do have smaller ones too. I just didn't get them. The 8-inch was for larger hats and larger hair. So here's just a small selection of beads. I've got a whole bunch of them here that are in individual little packets, and I've got all sorts here. So I have a whole slew of beads over here. I can't see them all. So, where to start? Well, pick your hat pin. One thing that is essential is some adhesive. I like to use E6000. It's good for just about anything. It's industrial strength, and ideally you should have the window open when you're using this, but that's if you're using mass quantities. I won't be. So if you're just going to use a little dab, which, okay, I'm having fun trying to get this out of the tube. I always have fun trying to get this out of the tube. This is why I have toothpicks. Because sometimes it gets clogged up in the end of the tip. And I've got to help get it out. I have to make an opening in the end of the tip, or it's not going to come out at all. There we go. Okay. So you get a little bubble of it and put it on a bit of cardboard. That way. And you have to use the little cap that comes with the tube, or you're going to end up with the whole thing just one hardened mass, and you really don't want that. So I think I'll do a 6.5 inch one. So you just use your toothpick, put a little bit of glue around the head, because there is a head on these right there. And try and get some of the glue around there. That, I'm not sure how well you can see that. I'm going to have to get a better camera. It's going to be a while though before I can do that. So we can use any beads. I had one where I had that and that bead, and a couple of bead caps, silver bead caps, and think I may put a pewter one in between there. So, here. So, let's start with, I'm going to use a bead cap here. It's just a, and it, let it get up into the glue. And add your bead. That's really, and put a second bead cap on there, so it, looks like that. I'm going to put a little bit more glue on the pin, just to make sure that the crystal stays on there, and so that this bead cap can stay on there too. There. So they ain't going no place. It will have to dry. Best to let it dry overnight for the best possible drying coverage. Now this bead, I want to put it in the hole, but I found, well, no, not if you do it right away. Never mind. I did another one where I put some bead around in, around the hole, and the glue left a bit of residue on the pin, but I was able to clean it off, because I can feel it. You probably can't see it, but I can feel it, like right there and right along there. If I had a better camera, I could do a close-up. This camera doesn't like to do close-ups too well. Let's see, what else should I put on there? I don't want to put too much else, because then it's going to look cluttered, and I'll end up with maybe that much of space to put into my hat. So I think I'll do one of these little bitty white seed beads. Yeah, you can sort of see it. It's there. And that will help keep it on there. Now, next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take one of these, which is a, probably can't see it too well. Maybe you can see it. I don't know. There's a little hole in the center there. What this is a clutch for ear wires. So if you have pierced ears and use the ear wires, you can use these to put them on the back of your earrings so they won't fall off. So we're going to stick that into one of these. Keep trying to get it right there. Not focusing too well. I have to fix that. What that is a crimp cover, C-R-I-M-P, cover. And what that does is it covers up a crimp bead, which is used to wrap onto, when you're making a necklace and using like a beading wire, you use a crimp bead because it's kind of hard to actually, oh, it's hard for me to think and talk at the same time. Oh, that says a lot. It's hard for me to think and actually do something at the same time. Okay, yeah, there, finally got it on there. is having a little bit of difficulty because this particular crimp bead is smaller than the other one I have, which is sterling, it's not sterling silver. It's a silver color. But then you take these, which are crimp pliers. These are used to take care of the crimp beads, or crimping beads, and then the crimp cover. See if I can do a better picture of that. There's two sets of curves. On one side of one jaw, there are two half moons. And on the other jaw, there's one larger half moon and two smaller half moons. So the two smaller ones connect up with the lower large one. And what they do is they take the crimp bead and they squeeze it together and have it so that there's like a score down the middle on one side of it. And then you take and you turn the bead and you put it in the other side where there's the two half moons coming together. And it will squeeze down the crimp so that it will be in alignment with it will cover that. But anyway, so with these pliers, you take and very gently, very, very gently, with the front two half moons, you get the crimp cover in between there, and then you very, very gently squeeze. You don't want to do it too fast, or you're likely to squeeze it out of shape. Sometimes you need to actually do, this is being really, really tight. But what that does is that it goes around the earring clutch. It's not running to close up tightly there. But you know what? It probably doesn't matter because nobody's going to really come up close and see your hatpin. So you take that and you slide that all the way to your beads. And that will ensure that the beads don't come off. So now you've got a good few inches. Get my tape measure here. You still have 4 inches inches of pin to stick into your hat. And this is a clutch. It looks like a little bead, but it's in the center, it's got like one of the earring backs. And you just pushing from the head, you push that in there, and there you go. And there you have a hat pin. Now you may want to clean off the end here, the lower part of any of the residual glue, but just let that sit for 24 hours and that's ready to go as a hat pin. Want to try another one? So let's see, what shall I do this time? There's that, that's a pretty. That's a coated crystal with a rose gold coating. So that could go on either that way or the other way. Well, let's see what we got here. Can put a pewter bead in there. It works. I don't know. I don't think so. See, I feel like I'm missing some. I am missing some beads. See, my nibbling has a cat, and the cat likes to climb on my table, and the cat was climbing all over my beads, and especially this one. And that, because it's triangular shaped, it's got beveled edges, especially here, and she would step on it and knock these beads flying. That sounds like it was not exactly something I wanted to see. Oh, here, let's do this. And this is an 8-inch one. And this is really neat. This is called a rondelle. And it's got crystals. And we can put that there. And then we got another crystal here that's got an aurora borealis coating on it. Or as they say on catalogs, an AB coating. That's what it means. If you look in a bead catalog and see that a bead has an AB coating, it means it's aurora borealis. That gives it some nice rainbow-like colors. So let's put that on here. And what do you think? Think that works? I think it works. We could also put a bead cap on there. No, that doesn't work. That's a smaller one. No, it just doesn't work. Okay. So, we could do it like that. Leave it like that. Maybe put one of these small little seed beads on there. Yeah. Maybe even put one on the other end. Take that off. Like I said before, I'm in the living room of my apartment, and you can hear everything that happens in every other part of the house. And right now, my nibbling, or their partner, is probably my nibbling, is preparing some food. I think that looks just lovely, don't you? Yeah, I think that works. All right, let's get the glue going. So, is this still viable? Sort of. That's another thing with the E6000 is you don't want to... Yeah, no. Don't let it sit too long or it will start drying. Okay, that's stuck. Get that little seed bead up there. Oh, that's just a huge mass of glue. Okay, nope. Need to get some more out. Where did I just put it? There it is. That's another thing. I tend to forget where I've left something. Let's get a little more glue out here. Just use a piece of cardboard and you're good to go. There we go, that's better. Stick it into the hole, around the hole, and slide that up. Oh, that didn't stick. Now, here's a little trick that you can do. Hopefully it works. Because on the website where I saw this, oh no, it's not going to work. Unfortunately, that pin back, that earring back, is too big for that hole in the rondelle. So I'm going to have to make sure that the beads themselves are going to be really up tight, close and tight in there. Because there's no way I'm going to be able to have glue so that will actually stick. I would have to put a big blob, well, why don't I? I was just thinking, I'm going to have to put a big blob of glue in there. Well, why don't I put a big blob of glue in there? And let's see. Yes, I know I left it open, but I plan to still use it fairly quickly. Okay. So a big blob of glue there. And a little more blob of glue on the other side. Come on. And that should work. Okay. It also should help this bead. And actually, I think I want the AB coating on the outside of that. Help that to stay in place. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Of course, now we've got glue all over that. A little bit more glue on the other side for the seed bead, which decided to end up with itself on the cardboard. That's not a good thing. This size seed bead, by the way, is an 8-0. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different sizes of seed beads I've worked with. The really, really tiny ones are 15-0s. Then we have the standard that everybody kind of knows, called the 11-0. I don't know what the 11-0, what the O part means, but it's just how, I'm not sure I'm going to use that. It's just how the beads are designated. I didn't designate them that, so don't blame me. Okay, let's see if I can get the problem with the silver ones is they are way too slippery. Keep trying to get them on there and they just want to slip and slide all over the place. And then next comes the pliers just don't want to squeeze it because they slip off too. Oh, I'm not going to get it with that. I am going to have to do the corrugated ones because the corrugated ones are so much easier. So anyway, so they have the 15-0, 11-0, 8-0, which is this size. Then there is a 6-0, which is a bit larger than this. And I have seen a 2-0, are about the size of pony beads, if you remember pony beads. And they're usually used for, they're all used for beaded jewelry. That came together so much better. I think I'll do it that way from now on. The two O's are great for things like macrame and such. And yeah, so there we go. A second hat pin. See, it's easy. People think it's hard. So now I have two hat pins. Let them sit here and trying to get them so that you'll still be able to see them. Okay, so let's do one more. A little bit of E6000 right under the head of the pin. I still haven't decided what I'm going to do. Ooh. Should we try that? I think that's a cool funky bead. I've got lovely
crystals in different shapes. I love this cube. It's got a silver coating on the back. Oh, let's see. And I've got a few other things here. Funky heart shape. Not with that funky bead, though. Oh, let's see. Ooh. How do these go together? Butterflies. No, that's just cluttered. That doesn't look good at all. Ooh, I know. Use a silver bead. Yeah, we'll use a silver bead. And then we'll do that one. And we can do that interesting pewter bead. And then what else here? Oh, and that's a bead cap. That would look stunning. I'm just guessing here. Yeah, I'm just making it up as I go along. That's pretty much how it goes. There we go. What do you say? I think that looks cool. I like it. Need another one of those bead caps up there. Here, let's put that one up there. Still take that off. I don't think the silver bead works. Oh, these holes can be fun sometimes. That. And that. And that. And that. And one more of these. Caps. Wow, that's got a tight knit hole. I would almost be able to keep it in there all myself. I like it. And since I'm making this for me. Okay. A little more glue time. Because it doesn't take long for the E6000 to start setting up. So, okay. So let's stick this all in there. Get some glue in there. Change toothpicks. Stay. Oh, I hate that. I hope those all dropped in through the onto my table. Yes. Okay. Let's try some more. One nice thing about the E6000 is it dries clear. Had enough on there residual, so that's not coming off. and just a teeny bit more. There we go. And I'm going to have fun getting it out the next time I use it. There we go. I don't think I'll put that little cap thing on the end with the crimp cover and the earring back. So I think that should be fine. There are 3 hatpins. Yeah, so 3 hatpins in like less than 10 minutes. And here's the hatpin, the first hatpin I made. And I've been wearing that around, and it stayed glued. It ain't going no place. Hat pins are easy. Hat pins are fun. All you need are pins, an assortment of beads, any kind of beads, as long as they go through the pins. And you need the beads to be a minimum of 1 millimeter in diameter, because the wires are, well, that's kind of hard to see. I'll take a close up. The wires themselves are 1 millimeter in diameter. So you have to have at least a bead with at least a 1 millimeter in diameter hole in order for the pin to fit through. So there's that. And there you have it. Not including this one. 3 hat pins. In less than 10 minutes. How simple is that? Now you don't have to depend on eBay or Etsy to find your hat pins. So there you go. And that's my little tutorial on how to make a hat pin. So how do you use them? Well, let's use the one that I made before. You just put your hat on. Now I wear my hair up in a bun in the back. Obviously in the back, I'm turning around, duh! You put your hat on, figure out where your wad of hair is, stick it in the hat. No, you don't need special holes, no, it's not going to ruin your hat, and make sure you get it under, and then as it comes through the other side, and you take your clutch, and put it on. It ain't coming off. And it's not coming off. And trust me, that hat will come off if I don't have a hat pin in. Now, a little bit of history with hat pins. Where did they come from? When did they start getting used? The first time you see them is in the 1400s. Really see them. Women who wore caps and veils, if they didn't have a band around on the outside holding the veil on, they needed to have something to hold the veil onto the cap. Women wore their veils with pins to keep them from blowing away. Then hat pins really started to come into prominence in the 1800s, up until about the 1840s or so. Women's hats were mostly bonnets, which were tied on. So the ribbons helped to keep the hats on. Around the 1840s or so, ribbons started not being a thing on hats. And it was just the hat on the head and no way to keep it on. So they started using the hat pins to keep them on. As the hairstyles got bigger and the hat crowns got bigger to accommodate over all the hair, the hat pins got longer, and there were hat pins up to a foot long to get through the hat, the hair, and then the other side of the hat. It was considered slightly dangerous to have the hats without something on the end, especially with the longer ones. You turn suddenly, you can
put somebody's eye out. Then with the suffragette movement in Illinois and Arkansas, they passed laws that women could not have hat pins longer than 9 inches because they were considered a lethal weapon. You get a long enough hat pin, and it's like you take the end off, it's like you can really stick somebody. And the suffragettes were doing just that. At one point in a court case, the judge demanded that they remove their hat pins and their hats, something that's just not done in public. A woman wore her hat, put her hat on before she left the house, and it stayed on until she came back home. You didn't associate with anyone if you did not have a hat on. It's societal norms. And according to society, if you went out without a hat, it just wasn't done. The judge caused a stir when he demanded that they take off their hats and their hat pins. With the advent of the 20s, when women started wearing their hair short and the hats became more like helmets, the cloche hats. Don't be fooled. Not all women cut their hair in the 20s. They just styled it in such a way that it looked short. If you've watched Downton Abbey when they got into the 20s, Lady Mary was the only one who cut her hair short. All the rest of the Lady Edith and Lady Cora, they didn't cut their hair. And Lady Violet and Isabel, they were of a different age, so they didn't cut their hair either. But the younger women, no, they didn't all cut their hair. Not all of them wanted to. So, but with the cloche hats and the shorter hair, and at least the hair with the chignons and the buns and everything, they moved lower on the head, so that it was harder to actually get a hat pin in. But there were still those who did use them. But what really did in ladies wearing hats with hat pins was World War II. You're going into a factory, you can't have your hair in the way, and you can't be wearing a hat. You could still have your hair covered, but it was usually some sort of kerchief. You've seen the pictures of Rosie the Riveter, the poster, and it was just a scarf that came around and was done up, tied up, and up on top, and all their hair was underneath it. And you needed to have that because if you're doing welding, you do not want to have long hair getting in the way of that welding torch. No, you don't want it. You don't want your head going up in flames. Thank you very much. So the war actually did away with hats and hat pins. And a lot of women really stopped wearing hats about that time. More's the pity. I mean, yes, there are ladies that still wear hats now. But for the most part, when I was growing up, nobody wore a hat. You maybe wore a hat to church. It depended on the church you went to. And the churches I went to, you could wear a little lace cap on top. You didn't have to actually wear a hat. But now, with all of us historical costumers wanting to wear things that are of a certain time period, most everybody I see who is doing historical costuming is usually doing some sort of Victorian costume. So if you're going to go Victorian, especially anything from the 1840s up to the 19-teens, they need a hatpin. So, on that note, I'd like to thank you all for watching. If you're subscribed, thank you very much. And you like this video, please hit the thumbs up button. If you haven't subscribed, hit the subscribe button. If you like what I'm doing, and if you'd like to support my channel and support the work I'm doing here, I have a link to my Patreon account and to my Ko-fi account down in the description. Thank you very much for watching, and please join me again next time. Thank you, and I bid you peace. Bye-bye.